Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we will fine-tune a foundation model to document classification using the Python SDK of Azure Machine Learning Studio. Okay, I already upload a video for those that are following my channel. I already upload the same experiment, but at that time I was using the UI of Azure Machine Learning Studio, and today we are going to do the same. We will reuse some components of what is available in the component registry in Azure Machine Learning Studio, and we will create an application and a pipeline which will allow us to exchange easily the LLM that we use to fine-tune this model. Then we will register in the model registry the fine-tuned model, and also create an online endpoint for prediction. So the first thing that you need to do is select the model that you want to use for the fine-tuning. We just go to the model catalog, we go to fine tuning tags, and we choose test classification. It's the task that we are for what we are going to fine tune the model. And then among we have 26 available models of different sizes. I'm assuming, by the way, that you already have the Azure subscription, the Azure Machine Learning Studio created, the service principal account ready to go, and also you had available quota to run this experiment. Why I tell you this? Because this fine-tuning, these experiments, requires some extra resources that originally don't or doesn't come with your subscription. Probably you may need to request additional quota. You go just to Azure Machine Learning Studio to the to the main page of the Azure Machine Learning Studio. In that page you had in the admin section the quota, and then you can select the subscription that applies and the region where you are located, and there you can select a quota for a specific for the specific family of virtual machine that you are going to use. If you are going to, this is in the case that you use a computer cluster. In the case that you are going to use serverless, you also may need to have at least in total additional cores to run the experiment that you plan to run the experiment according the LLM that you plan to use for that experiment. And why I say that? Because, well, it's not the same to fine-tune a llama to 7 billions, or even a llama to 7 billions, 70 billions, which is available for this active, for this tax, than a bear-based case that is obviously smaller in terms of the billions of parameters or millions in this case, than in comparison with the billions that has the biggest models. This is having an impact on the cost of fine-tuning the model, and not necessarily on the performance of the model, and you will see that at the end of the exercise. We will get a very reasonable metrics and performance just using a small model, and this will at least make you question if to use a very big model that of course they are using state-of-the-art technology and configurations and architecture, but for some simple tasks, and depending as well of the number of the classes that you are gonna use for your classifier, probably is not not worthy, but is too much use some of these big models for that activity. In our case, we are going to use a model available in Hugging Face. This is a text classification activity. We have six classes, and then we have here a description of the model. This is a publicly available. It's 20,000 examples divided in this splitting, 16,000, 2,000, 2,000, and then on with this and six clacks, six labels. They are organized in six different labels. It's correctly balanced, so you don't need to apply any technology to correct the balance of the dataset. So again, I return to the topic. Think two times before you design your experiment, which model you plan to use, and the requirements you have, because you will see that finally, probably for some activities like this, it's not really needed to use a model like a Llama 2 70 billion. Okay, in my case, I'm using the bare Bayesian case, but the code I'm preparing, or and later on I will post to the repository, is valid to use with any of the models that you see on the screen. We are going to reuse a component that is available on the designer. For those that saw the videos I posted before, we look at the designer at the beginning of this series of Azure Machine Learning Studio, and the designer had roundabout, let me remember, 225 pre-designed components that you can reuse. Just simply get the component and fit the component and configure the component with the right parameters. As you see here, we had this is a kind of black box component that you just simply configure and apply the inputs in terms of data and configuration for the training and the quantization component. And then you can also configure the output of the model. And again, this is up to you. You can also code and use the conventional Hugging Face classes, the trainer, the sequence-to-sequence trainer, that is the ones that apply for this component. But I will show you how to, using just this model, you can create a pipeline that is fully reusable and with very, very little, and probably even if we tickle the code sufficiently to allow to change the LLM, just changing the label or sending or using a parameter on the command line arguments, we will be able to change the model that we use to fine tune the experiment. No? Okay, so let's go to the code. So I give you here some interesting links how to increase the quota, because again, you are going to need, in my case, I couldn't run with the quota I had available. I already request two times to increase the quota that you get automatically when you create a subscription. I increase it two times, but still not enough to run a fine tuning with a Llama 2 7 billions. So, well, once I get it, I will try to run the same experiment and modify the code to just change via parameter the name of the model that we want to use. In any case, I give you the link how to the procedure to you request more quota. We can go, and you probably need to, as I said, request a specific quota for an specific family of virtual machine, or request quota in global, if you want to say that, yes, if you want to run the pipeline in serverless mode. In serverless mode, as you know, the Machine Learning Studio will take care of the infrastructure, and the only thing that you need is you need to have enough quota on your subscription to run to Azure Machine Learning allocate enough cores to the different components of your pipeline. So I send you as well a link to how MLflow is working and how you can collect metrics and logs, etc., from the experiments, and how this is organized depending on the subjacent technology that MLflow is working on. In total, machine learning, MLflow usually work in top of that technology. In this case, is the repository, the log repository that have MLflow. Sorry, machine learning studio. But this technology can be as well Databricks, can be a SQL Server, Postgres, SQLite, whatever. No, even the file system. So. another top, I send you here a link and how this is organized, and you can take a look and understand how MLflow is integrated in Azure Machine Learning Studio, as is a key component to monitor, to log, and to keep track of everything that is going on in your pipeline. I give you a link as well of the dataset. Here is a view of the client that we use to connect to the workspace. You will see later how we use the client to connect to, as well, to the different model registries, because also the models, the foundation models, are organized in different registries, and we need to connect depending on the model to different registries. And this is we point to the correct registry using a label. Here we will need to install, this is the library requirements. This is AI, ML is the machine learning library, identity to do login on the Azure and under, and then into the machine learning studio workspace, the dataset, Hugging Face datasets, and MLflow and Azure ML MLflow extensions. This is also important because we are going to work with these extensions. These extensions are adding additional functionality to MLflow to work inside Azure Machine Learning Studio. And here I give you an example of a guy who do similar exercise with Llama 2. Even he made an experiment with a Llama 2 7TB. Well, it's up to you. You want to spend that money? It's fine. I can. In my case, I will need to request, or probably 3 times more quota that I had available right now, and it's still pending on 6 additional cores just to run the 7 billion Llama 2 model. No? For the case of if you want to run the 70 billion. You may need around about 72 cores available in your subscription, in between 72 to 96 cores, because you may use 4 big servers with A100 GPUs to do this fine tuning. At least is how it's designed in Azure Machine Learning Studio. Okay, we import the libraries we need. This is quite similar to other experiments that we did. Here I import embed. Well, I had a bug. Later I will upload a video how to use embed. This is a very it's a very good tool that you may need when you are debugging code. You want to stop the execution of your code and see what's going on. You can use embed. Put this embed clause, embed method in the middle of the code, and you, the execution of your code will stall at that point, and it will launch a interactive Python terminal or console. In this case, once you are inside the console, the terminal, you can interrupt, you can query the status of any variable or any object that you had before the place that you place the embed command. Okay, we simply create some placeholders pointing to the data, and this is the location of this file, and this is the location of the dataset. Here also I provide a script which download the dataset from Hugging Face and create some JSON files in this case in the motion dataset directory. This is simply a copy of what is available in the Microsoft documentation, so it's nothing authored by myself. So you, I just use it, and then you can use this command, just passing in this argument dataset. This is the dataset you want to download, and this is the directory where you want to save the JSON files. So here we just load the environment and all the keys and parameters we need to do login in Azure and in Azure Machine Learning Studio. We look at this in other videos that we have loaded before, so we are not going to comment this more. So I create in any case a function which made automatically login in Azure Machine Learning Studio using my service principal account. And yeah, well, you can take a look to the code. It's here in this login.py in the folder src. Once we do the login, we print the main components of the workspace client, and then we create two additional clients, but these are specific clients to connect to registry model registries. And then you see here we don't need the subscription because they are connecting to other components. And then the only thing that we need is the credential, the same credential that is the service principal account. And then on here in Azure ML, you have most of the models are here in Azure ML registry, Hugging Face model, Azure Curate models, and Azure Research models. And a specific model like Meta, Mistral, or OpenAI, they are in their individual or specific registry. So you just need to point them if you want to use them. That's why we create here two different clients pointing to two different components. We give a name to the experiment, we create a timestamp to just give a name to the experiment and to the endpoint. And here we are connecting to the model, just to the registry. In this case, we connect to using the Meta registry ML client Meta to get the Llama 2 7 billions. And in case that you want to use the bare Bayesian case, is the model I'm using here, you will need to use the registry ML client. Once we get here, this obviously is going to override the two lines above, and then we print some details of the model. This we can observe is here. Once we do the login, here we have the clients. We connect to the registry, and then you get the case version 16, and this is the address or the URI in the model registry. Here we did this check. I also copy as well this from the Microsoft documentation. There is apparently some models that had a list of computer cluster or computer templates that are only the models are only allowed to run on those computer versions. And but to be honest, I didn't find one so far. I review probably 20 or 30. I didn't find any of them containing this information. But for what you say, there is some tags in the Model Foundation card. When you go to the specific model and you open the card information, you may see a section where you had a list of allowed computers, allowed templates. For this model, it doesn't have, also Llama 2 models doesn't have, so this here is just a sanity check that for now we will implement it, but it's not used in this case. For this, for the bare Bayesian case, I use this template, this VN family. Case that you are gonna use the Llama 2, you need to use a family that has at least one A100 GPU, at least one. And minimum, you will need to have four VNs with one A100. This is the how they had dimensioned this experiment and also the component that we collect from the registry. you may be able to run this in less in a in, yeah in in only two VNs, but according to the documentation, we will need four. That's why I need to request more quota for my subscription. And that's why I decide just to run this experiment with the Verum case model, which only need two of this family. So in here, I'm going to create the cluster, the infrastructure. I also create a class, not a class, a method, just to compute, to create the cluster. If you have it already created in this code, it's just getting the computer cluster from the workspace, and it's not, it's just creating the computer cluster. As you see here, just two, and this is only with this configuration only valid for the verification case. Again, case that you want to run the experiment with Llama 2, change this for a family which contains a A100 GPU. We make a pointer to the data directory, and then we point to the file that contains the labels, and we create a data frames. Also, to create the data frames, the pandas data frames, I create here a some helper function in datasets.py, and also with this I create as well the train, test and validation datasets. You can take a look here how they are created. Just open the JSON file and create a data frame, and then on this labels data frame is also used to create the train, test and validations data frames, and then we take a sample of these data frames to just for validation. Okay, now we print here, you see here also the logs of this exercise, of this experiment, and then on we start to create the dictionary of parameters for the training object. And here we create the parameters of the optimization object. If you look at the object that we have here, these parameters I'm defining in the dictionary are solo them here. You can, using this dictionary, you can configure everything that you see here is configurable via parameters using that object. Then on now you will see on the pipeline definition we will apply these parameters to this component. Here, here we have the we collect from the component registry the test classification pipeline. This is the object I just showed you. And here we create the pipeline. If you are going to run the experiment with the Llama 2 and comment this line and use serverless, I recommend you do it that way and comment these four lines. If you want to do it with the Verum case, keep it like this, like is in the code I will post to the repository. Here we just apply the inputs. If you remember, I will show you again. Here we just say what is the text input and what is the label. This is the two in this tags. You need to specify these two parameters. Here the number of parameters to use in fine tuning. This is the parameter GPUs per node is collected on the methods where I'm creating the GPU cluster. And here we pass the training and optimization parameters. We return the model using the we return the model to the output folder, and this is the URI that later on we will use to register the model into the model registry. If we go to the component just to review, you can see here No, but sorry, we will see later on the execution that we will see clearly how this all the inputs of the of this component once we the model is the pipeline is running. We create the pipeline here. We set that false rerun equals false. This means that we are not going to reuse the logs of previous runs or previous jobs, and here to stop if there is any failure in the pipeline. Here we once and here we are just submitting the job to the machine learning workspace, and here we are just streaming the logs. This is doing that way. We are just pulling every n seconds the logs from the machine learning workspace, and this the execution of this script will stop here up to the job is finished, regardless the status how it finished in the workspace. So you see here this job is already running, is uploading the data to the workspace, and here it give us the URL in the workspace is still running. We can go to look at the of the job. Okay, we have it here. So at this is the general view of the pipeline. This is pipeline level, so you can go here and get all the metadata and logs that is generated at pipeline level. So for now, we don't have we have logs only the initial logs. Then on is logging at component level, and later on. Now it's already doing the training. Let me open it. So you see here we are already training the model. I just training this model with one epoch, so it's not gonna. So you can extend this. I just did it to save some costs because at the beginning I used three, and it takes 1 hour 40 minutes to make three pods, and I decide just to reduce to one just to save some costs. And then on you can go to child jobs. You can interrupt the what you had at that level. You have here all the components, all the inputs, all the parameters of the component as well. You can go as well to the child objects, and you can interrupt how this component, which components had inside this text classification pipeline object or component. Now it's fine-tuning the model. You can go here as well. You can take a look what's going on this at component level. If you go here, you can see that the model is currently at 76%. So you can do here is enable log streaming. So we will it will be collecting here. You see it's now moving to 77, and surely it's collecting metrics at the end of the step of the execution. It will collect some metrics here. So you can follow one by one the step by step the activity, and here you see the how this model is organized. This you can replicate it as well with your own code, but to be honest is if you had this already done, it's better probably not to reinvent the wheel. You can here see and watch which code is being executed. This is the fine-tune code being executed on the on Azure Machine. This component is executing this model, and as you see here, those components and subcomponents are reusable. You can just take whatever is good or interesting for you, you just retrieve it and you just feed it with the information on the input and in the format that the tags or the component is expecting. The rest, well, again, you may want to use your own code or to do your own components. Actually, you can also take this component and create a tailored version of the same and save this component on the component registry, and later on, as we did in previous videos, collect this new component and use it in your own pipeline. This is up to you. Here we just use the components that are designed, but you can create the same pipeline. So you can take the original one and modify it, the original one with your own. Maybe you want to collect other metrics on a specific metric that is necessary for your business, whatever. You can change this code. Once you change it, you just save with in the component registry, and later on you can use this component for other pipelines or for your custom pipeline. Okay, now we let this running. We go the end of this model. Let's go here to continue with the code. Now we is working the model. After the model after the fine tuning is finished, here we just collect the download the model the logs from the workspace to local, and we check if the job is completed. Once this is done, we just print it. It is complete. This is still not happening in this execution. And then on what we will do is using MLflow. Here we collect the MLflow tracking URI is the address of the how we will localize this specific environment. And then what we are going to use is just set up in MLflow the tracking URI to the URI of this experiment, and then on filter all the experiments that we had in the database. At the end, Machine Learning Studio is using under the hood SQLite to keep all this metadata in a structured form, no? And then we can make queries using MLflow to that database. This database as well, by default, it will be SQLite, but it can be other database like Postgres, SQL Server, whatever you had in your company. It can be used as a database, as a backend of MLflow. By default, and in the default configuration, is using SQLite. So once we had this, we can query this database and collect all the information that is collecting MLflow during the execution of the experiment, of the job. And then what we are doing here is just looking at the experiment name. It's the experiment name is what we have in this case is text classification and motion detection. And then we will filter we will query this database, and we will collect all the runs for this experiment. And then once it's done, we will just print the metrics. Why we are going to print just the metrics of the current experiment? Because we are using the URI or the URI of this specific experiment. This is what we are collecting here in this code. So we are pointing, we are setting the tracking URI at the URI of our experiment, and then on we setting the we search using as well the filter that we have here, pipeline job name at the root ID. Okay, once this is done, we just print the metrics, and after printing the metrics, we just collect the model path. all the paths in Azure ML follow this format, is all of them starting. If you are working with other technology, for example Databricks, here instead of Azure ML it will be Databricks. Or if you are using SQLite as a directly without any other technology associated, it will be SQLite. Here, just point to the folder. Here, this nomenclature is exactly the same regardless of the technology. The only thing that changes is the head. Here, we are just telling MLflow that we want to retrieve this, or the location is going to be in an Azure ML component or object, and it will be a job. The job is the pipeline job name, and it will be on the output folder. The output folder is where we'll place all the artifacts by default. And you obviously you can create subfolders in output, but you cannot change this is by design. Everything that you log to the machine learning studio is going to be under the output folder. And the one is the trained model. By design as well, the component is saving the model in the training model folder. So what we are doing here is just creating the path where the component is saving the model after fine tuning, and then on we create a name to just later register the model into the model registry. Here what we are doing is using the model class. The model class is an object as well, which just prepare instantiate the class with the path of the model, which is in Azure Machine Learning Studio. The type, the name, the version is the, we use the timestamp for that, and a brief description. And then on using the Workspace client, the class model, or the class model inside the object, or the subclass model, inside the Workspace client, we use the object, the function create autodate, and we register the model in the model registry. We do the same with the online endpoint. We create a name, and using the manage online endpoint, we create an endpoint. If you saw the videos I uploaded before, I give you a description of what is a manage online endpoint and also what is a deployment. You may remember that we had two different classes of endpoints, manage online endpoints and manage batch endpoint. And then the endpoints itself, they are only a wrapper. It's the object that you are going to use to point your request to them. And then inside the endpoint, you have multiple deployments. You may have multiple deployments. You can have one, or you can have many. These many deployments can be different versions of the same models or different models that are trained with different data, but at the end they had to accept the same input. The only requirement is all the models need to have the same input. They need to receive the same input, and the model can be a llama, can be a bear case, can be different versions of the llama 2, or different versions of the bear case, or different versions of Mistral. Why we do it that way? Well, the idea behind this is, I mentioned before, you had a common entry point, and behind the entry point you had a deployment. This deployment is a model trained with some specific data, is a checkpoint of a model. You may want to, for example, evaluate how your new release, you are releasing a new version of your model that is in production, and you want to test how your model behaves with real data. And then you may deploy, you had a deployed model in a deployment with a name, and you deploy a second version of this model in another deployment, and you give to this model another name. And then on, in the employ, using the endpoint traffic parameter, you can split or balance the number or the percentage of requests that you redirect to every deployment. This is very common scenario to when you want to, again, either evaluate different versions of the same model when you are deploying a new version of the model that you had in production, or when you want to evaluate different tastes or different flavors of your model. For example, a bear case model or this classification test classification model, or a Llama 2 model. You have two and you may decide 50-50, 50% to one model, 50% to the other model, and you this is managed automatically by the managed online endpoint. You don't need to care about how it's balanced the traffic in between the different deployments, and then it will be done automatically by Azure Machine Learning Studio, and in this way you can simply later on receive from the logs who answer this request, every request that you send to the endpoint. It's very well designed a way to you later on evaluate the different models that you have in your endpoints. Okay, we create the managed online endpoint. We send it. We created using finally the Workspace client, and we create one single deployment. Here again, we give a name. We say which endpoint we want to include this deployment, the model that you are going to deploy in that deployment, the virtual machine family that you are going to use to serve this model, to serve prediction of this model, the number of instances. This is also managed automatically by Machine Learning Studio. You can have here four instances. It will be automatically balancing in a round robin the request across the different instances. You may want to decide a different approach. This is also possible. And this is the LiveNet approach. This is just doing a keep alive every 600 milliseconds. If I know wrong, this is, I know 100% sure, probably 600 seconds. If I don't remember wrong, it's 600 milliseconds, but I need to check that. And finally, we using the Workspace client, we deploy the deployment, and finally we define the traffic. All the traffic is going to be go to the demo deployment. Finally, here we just update the configuration of the endpoint. In that case, the endpoint is the managed online endpoint. And then how it looks like this on the Machine Learning Studio. If we go to models, we just had here, we will just have here another entry. I already ran two times and now it's running the third. And then the model is registered in your model registry. This is a bear-based case, fine-tuned with this data set for text classification. The same that we train the bear-based, you can train a Llama 2 or you can train a Mistral. Everything that was available among these 26 models in the fine-tuned text classification tags. And then the model is in the model registry, and then on in the endpoints you have also, you see here I run two times this exercise, and here this is the first one, because you may here you have the endpoint has a REST endpoint, and you have a deployment, and all the traffic is going to the deployment. So you can test here directly your endpoint. You can use, let me use some code I prepared here. Oops, where is this CRISPR line? Here. Yeah, we simply send this. This, I think. We send it, and here we are. You have the answer, and here you have the also if you have multiple deployments, any of them, it will give you Some pieces, snippets of codes, and how you can do that with your favorite programming language. One thing, additional thing I forgot, we say here that the authentication model is going to be a key. It can be as well a token. Doing with key is simple to deploy, to provide or to the distribute the key among different users in the that are going to consume the same point. Here I just prepare a small copy essentially the what we have in the as code snippet here, and just I adapt it to do a test, and as you can see here. Forget this because I tried before to do with the Workspace client, but it didn't work, and I will remove this for the final version. And then, well, you just prepare the request, the data, it had to contain the input data and some parameters. These two keys are mandatory. Here we include a list of lists with all the sentences that we want to classify. We send this is the URL that you have here, the resend point. Here we get the key from my environment .env file. We get it from with the .env with load the using .env values and the file that where we had the keys. We create the headers, as you remember, it had to be application JSON, had to contain an authorization header with your API, with your API key, and here you just include the deployment that you want to use for that request. If you have multiple deployments, you just can iterate with the same query, but changing the name of the deployment. This way you can collect, for example, all these requests and later on compare the outputs offline with a different tool. No? Here we just send the query. We just convert the response into a list, and we iterate through the list. Oops, sorry. Yeah, exactly. And then here we just iterate through the list with the predictions. So here I feel his answer, even now it's Joy. Here I had a few. Yeah, also Joy, Sadness. Yeah. Okay. Do your own test. Try to change. If you want to try another model, it's up to you. Yeah. The code is very easy. You can personalize this code with another model. It's quite easy. I think that you don't need to change too much. To get the same effect or the same outcomes I'm getting. To show you, and this is connected with what I commented you before. So if you look at here, I make some experiments with the bear case. So this is the experiment still running. These experiments of 1 hour, 33 minutes, I use 3 epochs in that. And take a look to the accuracy. We get a 93 just with 3 pods, or 90 in evaluation, and also the S1 is not bad. If you look at the metrics, and this, what I want to say with this, with just 3 reports, we are getting some metrics that are really, really not bad. And then if we extend this for example, to 10 or 15 epochs, I think we can hit easily 95-97% of the accuracy in evaluation. Here you see we are getting already 93. So this raises the question of, do we really need to use a Llama 2.7 billion for that activity? In my opinion, I will say no, because at least for this kind of classification with 6 to 10 classes is easily solved with a small model. If you remember or you follow my channel, I did the same with a DeFi. I did this experiment fine-tuning a model with another data set, a different one for other, in that case was using 10 classes. You can take a look to the channel. We use a DeFi base, which essentially is 500,000 half million tokens, half million parameters, half billion parameters in total. And with this model, ten classes to classify, we fine tune the model for human classification exactly the same that we did here in a Google Colab notebook with a A100, and we get 99% of the accuracy on F1. What means that well, probably a Llama 2 or Mistral 7 billions is too much for this activity, or at least for this number of classes. And this is something that you need to consider every time that you fine tune a foundational model. You need to look at the budget. You need to look as well how much money you are gonna need to do inference, because obviously, and you can, I give you here as well a detail to deploy this Bayesian case in a endpoint. We need a conventional inference endpoint. This is one of the cheapest families in Microsoft, and this one is well, probably 10 times expensive. Why? Obviously the model is bigger, and just to code the to put the model into memory, you need a machine with more RAM and with a bigger CPU, when sometimes you need even a GPU attached to the model. When you need to do inference for millions of requests of inference, this means a lot of money. And if the activity or the task can be solved with a smaller model, and this smaller model solve the task with a reasonable metrics and is on budget of the project, I suggest you to use it. That is just, I made that reflection. It's up to you how you want to deploy it, but this is something that probably you will need to consider at the time that you start the process, or you decide which model to fine tune for any specific activity or task. And that's all. Thank you very much for watching and for following me. And if you like the content that I presented to you, just give me a like, and if you are not subscribed to the channel, it's now time to do it. Thank you, and see you soon.